Hi, welcome to type 2 diabetes number 21. I'm Dr. Vladmir Carvalho, and I'm an endocrinologist. On this channel, we discuss everything about type 2 diabetes in a way that everyone can understand. Today, I'm going to answer one of my most asked questions, which is, how do I know if my beta cells are still producing insulin? How do I know my beta cell function? The test that's commonly used to know if your beta cells are still releasing insulin is called C-peptide test. But later, I'll tell you why it's not A or B or D, you know, why it's called C-peptide test. Now, let's say this is your pancreas, and this is one islet. And these are the beta cells that produce insulin. And let's take one of them outside. Now, just like I've mentioned before, glucose can freely get inside your beta cells of the pancreas and basically force them to release insulin. And insulin is also a peptide chain, you know, like two actually, A and B. But before we had this insulin, we had another molecule called proinsulin that has three chains, A, B, and C. And this C is what we call C-peptide. So we have this A and B that together we call insulin, and the other one is called C-peptide. Now, as you can see, we always have the same amount of insulin and C-peptide because they basically came from the same thing, right? So if you have one molecule of insulin, you also have one C-peptide. You have 100 insulin, you have 100 C-peptide because they came from the same thing. So that means that if you want to know how much insulin your body is still releasing, you can either measure insulin or you can measure C-peptide because the same amount of C-peptide is coming into your blood, right? Now, I know that some of you might say, wait, so why are you measuring C-peptide, right? Why don't you measure insulin that I'm looking for in the first place? And that would be right, but it's not. And the reason why we measure C-peptide is because C-peptide lasts much longer than insulin. Insulin doesn't last that long in the blood. So it's much more accurate to measure C-peptide because a lot of insulin, when they come to the blood, they'll get destroyed in the liver without doing anything, you know. But C-peptide is more stable and lasts longer. And another reason is that some patients take exogenous insulin, you know, inject insulin. And if you do that, and you measure insulin, you will not know if you're measuring the insulin that your body is producing or the one that you just injected, right? But if you measure C-peptide, you will know for sure that it's coming from your pancreas because the insulin that you inject does not have C-peptide. Now, the question is, how does knowing your C-peptide or knowing how much insulin your body is releasing can tell you about your beta cell function? And this is because, as I told you, the entering of glucose into your beta cells is dependent on the concentration of glucose. So that means if your blood glucose goes up, glucose will get into the beta cells and force them to release insulin. When glucose goes down, there's less glucose in your body, less glucose will get in, and less insulin will be released. I'll link a video here if you want to know all these steps because I have talked about these steps in details before. So more sugar in your blood always equals more insulin. And less sugar always equals less insulin. They go together. They go up together and they go down together. Because whenever glucose gets in, whatever happens next is almost automatic. You know, this is not like politics, you know, that they might ask for your vote, promising that they're going to do something. And then they get into office, well, I don't want to get in trouble, but you know what I'm talking about. But glucose doesn't do that. Glucose, when it gets inside, it gets the job done. Insulin will always be released. If it doesn't, that means that your beta cells are not functioning well. And that's why we are here. Now, what's the normal C-peptide range? In most labs, you'll see numbers like 0.5 to 2. But it can be different depending on the method that is used in your lab. But you don't need to worry because your doctor will know what is the normal range in your lab. And normally when you see your results, let's say 1.3, you will see the range on the side. Now, let's say that you have done the test, right? And you have the results in front of you. How do you know if your results are good or bad? Now, of course, you have to ask your doctor, but I'll give you a few examples that will make you understand clearly how to look at those numbers. Let's say you have a low C-peptide and a very high glucose. Now, as I said before, this is not supposed to happen because glucose is high. It's supposed to force the beta cell to release insulin and C-peptide, right? But it's not because it's low. That means that your beta cell function is not good. This is normally seen in patients with type 1 diabetes because their immune system destroys these beta cells. So they can't release insulin. And you also see in patients with type 1.5, like LADDER, for example, or if you have type 2 diabetes and you wait for too long, you didn't do anything about it until a lot of these beta cells are destroyed. In those cases, even though glucose is high, you don't have enough beta cells to make insulin. Now, let's say your C-peptide is high and your blood sugar is also high. That means that there is, again, too much glucose, too much sugar, probably from the food. But this sugar is able to make your beta cells release insulin because there's a lot of insulin coming here. So that means that your beta cells do not have any problem. But sugar is staying in your blood. It's not going to other cells. That means that your body, the other cells in your body, are resisting insulin and sugar. That's what we call insulin resistance. Now, this is normally seen in people who are overweight or at least in earlier stages of type 2 diabetes. Because your beta cells are functioning, but the body is resisting insulin. But at least this one is better than the first one, right? Because at least you have a good beta cell function. It's just that your body is resisting this insulin and glucose. So if you change your diet, let's say you start a diet with lower glycemic load, like some types of vegan diet or low carb diet, you know, without these refined carbs, things that can change quickly into glucose, and all these drinks and, you know, things that people are eating now, you can reduce this insulin resistance. You can lose some weight and reduce this insulin resistance. And if you add some exercise, you might just go back to normal, you know. Now, let's look at another one. Let's say your C-peptide is high again, but your blood sugar is low. So what do you think is happening here? You know, now you already know that this is not supposed to happen because glucose is low. So beta cells should not be releasing a lot of insulin. But these guys are still releasing insulin, you know, just in this case, you might be taking medications like sulfonylureas that I talked about before. Because those ones, they force your beta cells to release insulin even when there's no glucose. Or you might have something like insulinoma, which is a tumor of the pancreas that it's normally benign, but still cause problems. Too many beta cells, so they just release too much insulin. But, you know, your doctor will know. Now, let's say that your C-peptide is low and your glucose is also low. That means that insulin might be coming from outside, like you might be taking insulin, or you might be eating some types of low carb diet that, you know, does not have enough glucose to cause a lot of insulin to be released. Now, I will not write all the possible examples here because of time, right? But if you have a specific one in your mind, you can write in the comment section and I'll just answer it. Now, before we go, there are some things that I would like to mention. The first one is that whenever you measure C-peptide, you should also measure your blood glucose, right? Otherwise, you will not know anything. Because if your C-peptide is low, right, you don't know if your beta cells cannot produce insulin or your blood sugar is just low and your beta cell doesn't need to produce insulin. You know, so if you just take the test and do not measure your blood sugar, it's almost like useless. Number two is that endocrinologists might not always tell you to have a C-peptide test. You know, sometimes I see videos on YouTube saying, oh, a C-peptide test, you know, the best test that your doctor doesn't know about, you know, stuff like that. But I can tell you that every endocrinologist knows what's a C-peptide test and, you know, orders them regularly. But the problem is that sometimes you don't need to do a C-peptide test to know if someone's beta cell function is good or bad. Let's say you come to the office, you know, you are 300 pounds, you know, overweight. You surely have a good beta cell function because insulin is the main anabolic hormone that makes you gain or maintain weight. So you cannot be overweight and have a bad beta cell function. Now, let's say that your blood sugar is really, really high and, you know, your A1C is 15 or something like that. And then you have lost like 20, 30% of your body weight and, you know, you're young. We just look at you and we know that, you know, maybe your beta cell function is not good. And sometimes patients with very high blood sugar, even if their beta cell function is good, the beta cells might not release insulin because glucose is toxic to your beta cells. So your doctor might not, you know, do the test and just wait and do it later or something like that. So it depends. But, you know, it is a good test and it is the test that can be done to know your beta cell function. I just hope that this video is not longer than I think. So have a blessed week. Bye.